You're listening to a High Voltage Radio Network podcast. Find more at highvoltageradio.com.
This podcast is a member of the Place to Be Nation family. Visit us at placetobenation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world.
Down with the king!
Yo, you know what it's about, so let's tell them why you're mad.
You know what really grinds my gears?
A man!
I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not gonna take this anymore!
Now for something completely different.
It's time for a royal rant, presented by the Kings of Sport. And welcome to the Kings of Sport, the program changing the game one show at a time, aka the world's most dangerous sports show, aka iTunes' longest running weekly episodic program produced and hosted by two or more African Americans who are not affiliated with a major network. Happy New Year, everybody. This is our first official show of 2019, even though the last episode came out in 2019. It was recorded last year, so this is our first official show of 2019. I am your host, the Godfather Nate Milton. This is a Royal Rant edition of the podcast, and we'll let you know part of the reason for that in a second. But I must bring in my tag team partner, if you will, ladies and gentlemen. He hails from the city of Angels. Give it up for Marcus. I was trying to tie something into Jacksonville, and okay, hold on. Let me run that back. Give it up for Marcus. I'm editing on the fly. That way I don't have to spend 3 hours doing it later. Give it up for Marcus. I need a money.
Doorbell.
Man. Doorbell.
Plot twist. Hold on. I'll be right back.
Uh-oh. Swerve. Could that be the illustrious money man that I was speaking of? This is so exciting. It's like Craig Robinson in Pineapple Express. This is so exciting. We'll see who Marcus is talking about. Just a programming note, we are expecting to talk to TJ McAloon in a little bit this week to not only speak about the college football national championship game between Clemson and Alabama that took place this week, but also to talk about Inspire Pro Wrestling. And Marcus is back, ladies and gentlemen.
Woo!
I'm back for Marcus. Was that Shad Khan at the door? Because if so, this might be a short episode. Vandenberg, how you doing, brother?
How you doing, Nate?
Was that indeed brother Khan at the door? Can we cut this broadcast off right now? Because we about to get paid.
Nah, it was brother UPS with a delivery. So.
Oh. That's not elite at all.
No, it's not.
It's the opposite of elite. But yes, I was just letting the people know, we are going to talk to friend of the program, TJ McAloon, coming up here in a little bit, and to not only recap the championship game, but to speak about, Inspire Pro Wrestling. And maybe TJ will want to talk about, our top story here as well, in a little bit, because TJ might have a slight connection to that. So I think what we'll do, Marcus, we're programming here on the fly. Let's talk a little bit about what happened in Jacksonville today. Then we can go to the college football. And then when TJ comes on, we can go back around to the news conference that happened today.
Okay.
So for those that were living under a rock or had to be at work when this was going down, there was a big announcement. There was a big event in Jacksonville, Florida today, because why else would you want to where else would you want to be, Marcus, besides Jacksonville, if you're announcing something that could be life-changing for a lot of people? So, for those in the audience that aren't aware, let them know what exactly went down in Florida today.
SmackDown Live. All right.
I mean, it's the biggest event of the year. Like, I got my Rusev Day shirt ready. I would not wear any other shirt than a WWE owned and operated and produced shirt to a WWE event. So they can't kick me out, brother.
Yeah, that's here. That's the new policy, allegedly. But no, AEW, All Elite Wrestling was formally announced today. There was a press conference in Jacksonville. Why Jacksonville? Because the money men behind AEW are the Khan family, Shad and Tony Khan.
The Khan man?
Tony Khan follows me on Twitter, so I will not say anything bad about Tony Khan. Alright? So,
I'm just saying that brother's last name is Khan.
How dare you, Tony, if you're listening, I'm sorry.
Hey, Tony, to be fair, whenever I play Madden, I always pick the Jaguars because the cons come with a lot of salary cap room. Let's just say that.
What are you trying to say about the cons?
I'm just saying, I'm glad they're involved with this endeavor. But let's just say let's keep Blake Bortles as far away from this as we can.
they are the owners of the Jacksonville Jaguars. They also own Fulham, the soccer club over in England.
Yes, yeah. And you got to have a little bit of change to own a Premier League team.
Yeah, I mean, that's not a bad life to own a football team and a football team. Fulham FC, which they are not.
Is that
very
why
good.
They get so many of the London games? Because they've got over there in England?
That is, even though they do not play their games at Craven Cottage, because that is a not big enough stadium, but there is a England-London connection there with the Jaguars, and that's part of the reason why.
Okay. Your boy Shad was there looking real happy today.
I missed that part. Did they show him on camera?
Yeah, they showed him on camera, and there's some still photos you can see of him where he is just beaming in his suit with his All Elite Wrestling cap on.
What about the mustache? Was the mustache elite today?
I mean, the mustache is always all in. So
okay.
A double or nothing. I guess that's the next event we got to look forward to.
Yes. So at this event, they ran through sort of the talent that has been signed. I guess the bit surprise would be Chris Jericho, yep. Followed by Joey Janela, which I don't think has been linked to them prior to today, but Jericho was a surprise considering his history with the WWE. Yeah, there was no Kenny Omega announcement. Kenny Omega is still under contract technically until the end of the month, so yeah. I would not expect anything before then. And then they announced their Double or Nothing show Memorial Day weekend in Las Vegas, which that should be fun at the MGM Grand Garden Arena. And
is that an event that you might be traveling to since they are in your second home?
That is a event I will likely be at. Yes,
and it's smart too. Like, not that the All In show in Chicago wasn't great, but I think expanding, particularly to an area like Vegas, which we've seen has supported the UFC shows, I think it's a smart move.
Yeah. I do like the holiday weekend aspect because it allows people to travel.
And your boy Conrad out there looking like a big game James. He didn't waste any time either because he's already announced StarCast 2.
StarCast 2 is back. Conrad Thompson was the MC of this press conference, which was a surprise to see. A good surprise.
It was Conrad and who was the other guy?
Alex Marvez.
Yes, Marvez.
And I think one of the big takeaways was Brandi Rhodes announcing that the talent will be paid equal, men and women, which
yes,
that is a huge step in the right direction. That's something that is uncommon in wrestling, uncommon in sports. Yep. So the fact that this is sounds like a priority for them to have equal pay is, I think, important.
Yeah, I thought that was really cool, Marcus. But there was a couple things about this that I found very interesting, even apart from the fact that we'll have another wrestling organization. One was the equal pay for women, like you mentioned. Another was the proceeds going to the charity for the victims of gun shooting.
Yes, and that's the second show they're doing.
That's the one that's going to be in Jacksonville, back in Jacksonville, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And then the third thing was the prospect of healthcare for the workers that they were talking about.
Yes.
So, like, even besides the wrestling aspect of it, they're talking about things that if it's feasible and if they can get it done, these are things that might push other companies, say the WWE, to look into becoming more hospitable to their workforce. So I think that might be the bigger thing, even outside of just pro wrestling.
Yeah, if you're not familiar with the cons, I mean, they are billionaires and they have money to spend, and if they want to truly flex their muscle in the wrestling industry, they have the resources to do so.
Yeah.
No TV deal was announced, but if you were to believe some dude on Twitter, which, I mean, excuse me, some dude on Reddit, not even Twitter, some dude on Reddit, it sounds like, have you heard about this rumor, Nate?
No, not yet.
So word on the street, and word on the Reddit square circle street.
Word on these Reddit streets?
Yes, is that a TV deal is done. It's not announced yet, but it's in the final stages, I guess. And it would put All Elite Wrestling on TV on Tuesday nights on TNT.
Marcus, I was with you until you got to the last line.
No, TNT doesn't do it for you? Too many flashback memories of Nitro?
Like, I get it that in the show called Tuesday Night TNT or something like that.
Tuesday Night Dynamite something, yes.
Okay, so I get the correlation with Dynamite and TNT, but have we seen any indication that the Turner Networks would want to get back into the wrestling business in the last 15 years?
No, but to be fair, I mean, I think Ted Turner's still alive and still going, but I don't know if there's a lot of people that are still left over from 2000, 2001.
2000 regime.
That were sort of responsible for the end of WCW. I mean, it's been, 18 years now?
Yeah.
If you're Turner, you have seen the success NBC Universal has had with USA and wrestling. Since WCW departed, you now have seen Fox get into the wrestling business. You know, I think
even just as programming, it's programming that you don't have to produce.
It's programming you don't have to produce. It's live programming.
Yeah.
It's going to be weekly programming. It's going to definitely attract a younger demographic. You know, it all comes down to how much money they're going to spend to get this thing. You know, if it's something that is manageable, then
like it's a great rumor, Marcus. It's like great fantasy booking, and I would actually love to see that happen, because I think if that were to pass, you've immediately got them in the space as the number two promotion in North America, or at least in America. I'm not going to go as far as, you know, to count Mexico or Canada, but. And I do think there's a TV deal out there for them. I had always been under the impression that WGN was going to be one of the players for this. But as long as they can get anything better than the Pursuit Channel, no shade to Impact or Pop TV or Destination America, I think that's a win for them in this current climate.
I mean, if this is true, I think this is a huge win for this promotion. I was not expecting a promotion like or a network like Turner to be on board right away.
Then again, we don't know the relationship. Like, maybe Ted Turner and your boys Shad and Tony, they cool like that. So maybe there's personal relationships that we don't know that are at play as well.
Yeah. So that would be
because you know they run in different circles than you and me, Mark. Because they in that Byron Allen range. They were we trying to get to.
We're crumb snatchers, and they have all the crumbs.
We ain't in that mogul tier yet.
No. But yeah, no TV duo, no Kenny Omega, and
I think both of those are coming though.
I think both of those are coming soon.
Because if you're Kenny, and I talked about it a little bit with John on the Impact show the other night. If you're Kenny Omega, yeah, you might be able to get some more money out of the WWE, but everything else to me tips in the favor of All Elite Wrestling. If you're talking about working with your friends and creative freedom and you know being a bigger fish in a smaller pond, like why wouldn't you go there?
Especially, I mean, the money is going to be comparable. Then, yeah, there's it'd be one different than money if they're paying quote unquote indie money for these guys. And yeah, I would understand why he would want to go to WWE. But if the money is going to be on par or even close to being on par to what he would get in the WWE, then yeah, there's no question.
So are you looking forward to this? Are you more enthusiastic about the prospects of All Elite Wrestling now than you were, say, 24, 48 hours ago, brother?
I am. I still have, production-wise, that's going to scare me still. I mean, this press conference was not smooth. I understand it's streaming and all that stuff, but these are the things you take for granted when you watch a company like WWE, where week in, week out, you know what you're getting. You know it's going to look good, at least. You're not going to have any issues. So that would be my major concern. I am curious. I know a lot of these talent have these executive VP titles or whatever they're floating out there, but I would be curious to know who is actually behind the scenes helping them get this promotion off the ground. I think that is very important. This is where I would, having someone like a Don Callis or a Scott D'Amore would probably not be a terrible thing, but they're sort of tied up with that other promotion. I wonder.
I wonder if that's not, yes, there was a big deal made about Jericho. I wonder if his benefit is not just strictly with wrestling, but maybe from a creative kind of organizational standpoint.
It'll be like he would have another role behind the scenes.
Yeah, because to me, if you're looking at who on the roster would have experience in terms of maybe being a booker or being somebody that has structured matches together, maybe like in that agent type of role, it'd be Jericho.
That's true. And curious about the broadcast team as well.
I mean, I ain't got no calls yet, man.
There you go. I'll tell Tony to DM you.
Yeah, holler at Tony. Let's see, Cody. Cody's liked one of my tweets in the past. Maybe that's enough of an entryway to get in. I would slide in Brandy's DMs, but I don't want those problems if it go sideways.
Yeah.
I was just looking for a job, baby.
Yeah.
Now I got Cody Rhodes trying to come up here to Virginia to fight me. I just wanted to do play-by-play. I just wanted to be your Kevin Kelly.
Yeah, those are the.
I'm kind of with you though, Marcus. Like I held off on my big excitement, around New Year's when everybody was getting all hyped about the company. I kind of held off on my excitement, kind of reserved judgment or whatever. But seeing this, and especially like you were talking about, seeing the things that I think are important, not just for this company, but for other companies and other workers in the business, whether you're talking about equal pay, whether you're talking about healthcare, whether you're talking about a promotion that is looking to be beneficial when it comes to social causes. Like that to me is the more intriguing thing. Like can they actually do it in the current climate?
Yeah, that's going to be interesting to see. Oh, one other thing they mentioned was wins and losses are going to count more than ever, whatever that means.
Wait a minute, Marcus. Wait a minute. You're telling me on a pro wrestling show. Let me see if I'm following you here. On a pro wrestling show, the wrestlers' wins and losses will have an impact on how they progress in the storylines.
What a concept, right?
That is revolutionary.
Man.
I think it'll be fun, man. Are you a big watcher of the All Elite? What is it? Being the Elite?
Being the Elite? Yeah. No, I am not.
I'm not either, but like when I hear buzz about a certain episode, I'll check it out. Mm-hmm. But yeah, seeing what those guys do, and especially like when you're talking about Daniels and the SCU guys, like I think, and here's the big if. It's always the big if, isn't it, Marcus? Whenever you do a startup, if people can keep their heads on straight and their egos in check, I think they can do some really cool things.
That part I'm not too worried about. I mean, they all seem pretty close.
I mean, you watched the Temptations movie, didn't you, Marcus?
Yeah.
Everything was all cool when they was just a little doo-wop boys on the corner, but when that money started coming in, Eddie thought he was bigger than Otis. David Ruffin, ain't nobody coming to see you, Otis. I'm just saying, I just hope everybody can remain professional and remain friends.
Let's try to guess who would be the one that would turn first. Cody?
Would be the David Ruffin of the group?
Yeah.
Got to be one of the Bucks, right?
No, I think the Bucks sit together to release themselves. They'd be loyal to each other.
Right, right. So then, let's assume Kenny comes in.
All right.
All right, so between Kenny and Cody and Jericho, who's the David Ruffin?
Kenny. Because Kenny would jump ship. He would go to WWE.
Yeah, ain't nobody coming to see you, Cody.
Yeah.
Yeah, so Kenny's David Ruffin. I think Jericho would be Eddie Kendricks. Like, he'd be the second one to leave.
He's old. I don't know. I mean, what else? Where is he going back to WWE?
He's always probably going to have that option if he wanted to. I mean, I know there's probably some hurt feelings about the cruise and whatever, but I think that could be soothed over time.
I would say the Bucks.
So you said the Bucks would be the next to leave together?
Yeah.
So the Bucks together are Eddie Kendricks. Cody's blue. Cody's Otis. I think Cody's in for the long haul.
Otis, yeah, Cody's going to be there till
the door's closed.
Till Shane McMahon's son comes out one day and says, I bought AEW.
Oh, man. Brandon be there like Blue's mother in the movie when Blue died. You was the only ones who kept them all together, Otis. You was the only one, Cody, that kept them all together. I'm probably ruining my chances for that play-by-play gig, aren't I?
Probably.
So let's let's go from the greatness of All Elite Wrestling, and again, we'll pick that up a little bit later when TJ hops on, and let's talk about the National Championship game, Marcus, because these were allegedly the two elite teams in the NCAA. And we had another rematch, but a different outcome this year than last year, brother.
Yeah, a Clemson rout of a Nick Saban coach team, which is something you don't see very often.
44-16, number two Clemson beat number one Alabama.
Yeah.
Is it true, Marcus, that in the age of this current setup, for determining a champion, that the number one seed is number one? Like, is that true?
Because Bama wasn't the number one seed last year. Clemson wasn't the number one seed the year before. Ohio State. Yeah, that's right.
That's crazy.
Yeah, so 15-0, Clemson Tigers. Led by head coach Dabo Sweeney, who is more of a preacher at times than coach. Trevor Lawrence.
Your boy Sunshine.
Looks like Matt Riddle.
Okay, so you go Matt Riddle. I go Sunshine Ronnie Bass from Remember the Titans.
See, as I haven't seen that movie, so I don't get the reference. I know who he is, but doesn't do anything for me.
Oh, that might have to be something we do for our impending Patreon. Like, we might have to do a review. You and I watch Remember the Titans and then get on and talk about it.
That'll work.
I can't believe that you have never watched that movie. And not only are they teaching about football, Mark, they teaching you about life.
Well, it's also Disney, so.
And it is Disney. And yeah. Denzel's in it. So, like, there's a lot of reasons
That's one of the few Denzel movies I haven't seen for some reason.
There's a lot of reasons why you should have already seen this movie.
I know. But, yeah, Trevor Lawrence, the freshman QB who took the job of Kelly Bryant and kicked Kelly Bryant out to Missouri.
Speaking of which, can we just say, Marcus, like, I'm not one of these people that's hating on your boy Trevor. Like, I understood when Dabo made the decision to switch quarterbacks, mm-hmm. and I also understood that, you know, Kelly Bryant had a right to transfer.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, I got people coming at me talking about, see, Dabo made the right decision. Like, I never said he didn't make the right decision. Like, see, Kelly Bryant should have stayed. He would have got a championship ring. I don't know why all these Twitter people had the same accent. Actually, I do know why. Like, Kelly Bryant should have stayed and got him a ring. Like, which would he rather have? A ring? Which I believe he already has a ring from being a backup. Bryant? Another team on the title, yeah.
He's going to get another ring, too.
Yeah, so it's like,
despite leaving, he'll get a ring.
Why don't you just stay and get a ring? Like, no, why would he want to be the backup on a championship team when he could have another year of eligibility? Like, that's, but people still, like, in South Carolina that are still hating on Kelly Bryant, like, get over it. You guys got your ring. Get over it. Be happy. Leave this kid alone.
I mean, Kelly Bryant knows how good Trevor Lawrence is. He left for a reason because he knew that Trevor Lawrence was not going to lose his job ever.
You know how good Trevor Lawrence is?
How good is he?
Trevor Lawrence is so good, Marcus Vandenberg, that we are about 4 or 5 minutes into talking about the national championship game, and we're not even talking about the man that was the runner-up for the Heisman this year.
Tua Tagovailoa.
Your boy Tua. Yes. You can say his last name.
Yes. Trevor Lawrence is, he's the real deal. People are now drooling over this kid.
No, they were saying if he came out in the draft last night, Marcus, he'd be the number one pick off the board. I'm like,
well, I think that's more an indictment on this year's draft, not so much on how good Trevor Lawrence is.
Because
at 19, he would get killed in the NFL. I mean, yeah. There are times last night in the fourth quarter when he was running, I was like, dude, why are you in the game? Like, you won. Don't get hurt. But, yeah, Tua Tagovailoa did...
It's very well done. Very well
not
done.
...not play that great.
No.
Some turnovers. And Alabama, they just feel like Clemson figured out how to scheme them and how to stop them. And I think from that first pick six on, even though Alabama came back and scored some points, you sort of just knew that, okay, this is not going to be your typical Alabama game.
Right.
They were in for a long night. And, Clemson did not allow Alabama to score after halftime, which is impressive. And Nick Saban, I guess he handled it well. I don't know. He didn't go full like Belichick, but he didn't actually say a whole lot. But Nate, what did you think about the game? And I guess does this sort of change your view on Saban's dynasty in Alabama?
I thought it was a good game. I think that this win to me does, like, the loss doesn't do a whole lot to detract from Nick Saban for me. I think he's already cemented his legacy, both at Alabama and in the history of college football. But this to me adds to Dabo's legacy because you can make the argument that he actually outcoached Nick Saban, which I don't think a lot of people can have stated on their resume.
Mm-hmm.
We've talked about Dabo on the show before. Like, I'm hot and cold with Dabo in terms of in terms of the way he chooses to motivate his players. sometimes he does come across as more of a, like a salesman or, you know, one of those televangelists.
Yes.
All you got to do is give me a call, brother, and send $49.99, and we'll send you this wonderful healing tapestry. but I thought it was a good game, man. And as much as I want to see the college football playoff field expanded to 8 teams, because I think that would be the most fair way to discern who the true champion is, I think it wouldn't matter if you had 8 teams, 12 teams, 24 teams in the playoffs this year, Marcus. You still would have gotten to these two teams who right now seem to just be a step ahead of everybody else.
Yeah. I mean,
like, it wouldn't surprise me if we're back here next year, same time, and we're talking about Clemson and Alabama again.
For the fifth time.
Yeah.
I would not be surprised either. Well, it won't be USC after today.
You mean, what happened to USC, Marcus? What went down?
Well, a certain offensive coordinator got a new job elsewhere, and I wish him best in his future endeavors.
Sounds like you're not too sold on his resume.
I'm not. I mean, just kind of curious. A guy did fired from a job and then did a head coaching job in the NFL, but
yeah,
it's none of my business, though.
Especially if you, you know, if you're making commitments to these unpaid kids and you're telling them you're going to be there.
Yeah.
I mean, then you're not there.
Not like I know any of these kids that are going to USC in the future. So, anyways. I mean,
if we can hold Kelly Bryant to the fire for deciding to leave, why can't we hold these nameless offensive coordinators and coaches to the same standard?
Mm-hmm.
But we're not gonna say no names though, Marcus. No. We're not gonna be that petty to start off the new year.
No.
We'll save the pettiness for when TJ comes on.
Yes, he'll be on soon. He's already tweeting about his appearance. It's all about TJ. what was I gonna say?
Talking about
Clemson, Alabama 5.
Yep.
Oh, yes, any teams that can compete. You're always going to have the same, you know, your Georgias, your Ohio States. I think Oklahoma, despite losing Kyler Murray, is going to be really good next year. They have a top quarterback recruit coming in. They have, I think, 3 5-star receivers coming in. They have some holdovers from this year's team. Lincoln Riley, I think, is an offensive genius, and Oklahoma was smart to lock him up to an extension, so I think they'll be in the mix. But yeah, I think you're right. Barring any injuries or any wackiness, I do think that the best two teams in the country are Alabama and Clemson, and I think similar to what we saw with sort of the Warriors and Cavs in the NBA, do you think this is bad for college football?
I think it's good for college football, but I do think it's bad only in the sense that when you only have 4 teams and you got 2 that are almost guaranteed locks, the amount of space for everyone else to debate and argue and get excited about is very limited. And that's why I think, you know, 8 teams to me is like the perfect amount, for the postseason. But like I said, man, even if we would have had 8 teams or 12 teams this year, we would have gotten to the same destination. But I do think it's more fun the more teams you have in, because then you have more chances and more hope for some of these other schools out there. I haven't quite gotten to the point yet where I hate Clemson like I hate Alabama. Like, there's still the baby faces for me, but they're getting to that John Cena point. You know where John Cena was like the baby face for way too long?
Uh-huh.
And the top guy for way too long, and the crowd just started to turn on him. Like, you know, mid-2000s, 05, 06, 07, before he kind of came full circle, and it was cool to cheer Cena again. Like that's where I'm at with Clemson. Like they're right on the cusp of becoming a heel, and then we get a heel versus heel matchup between these two teams for the next two years.
I think what helps Clemson is they're not in the SEC, and I think SEC teams in general are a bit tired.
SEC fans, particularly. Yeah.
So because they're not in that conference, I think that sort of cuts down on their exposure a little bit. So I don't feel like they're ever at that point where they're just Clemson, Clemson, Clemson. I mean, I don't feel that way during the regular season.
Yeah, Clemson fans aren't quite unbearable yet. Like, not yet.
I mean, do you know any? Who are Clemson fans? Do you know any?
I don't know any Clemson fans in real life. Like, the only Clemson fans I know are the ones that hit me up on Twitter at 2 in the morning to give their hot takes on Kelly Bryant that are unsolicited.
Yeah, because otherwise, I don't know. I mean, I know Bama fans and SEC fans, but I don't know many Clemson fans. And yeah, part of that, too, is Clemson's just a tiny school.
I know more South Carolina Gamecock fans than Clemson fans, quite frankly.
Yeah, so do I.
So, shout out to the drunk Clemson fans that are out here on these Twitter streets late at night. Dear so-called kings of sport. Ding!
I was waiting for that.
Yeah, hey, I gotta get all my stereotypes out before TJ hops on the line.
Where is TJ?
Let's see, is TJ ready to roll? Let's see. This is all part of that live radio goodness. Yeah, because he's out here tweeting about it. So if you're gonna tweet about it, be about it. All right, TJ just sent me a message. Okay. TJ's sending me secret messages about people that are going to appear at his event. Like, I feel good that we're finally bringing TJ on, but you know what I feel bad about, Marcus? And he won't know until he actually comes on the line.
What's that?
Like, we're only giving TJ like 10 minutes. Like,
that's all he deserves. He just had a show over the weekend. He's fine.
Like, this show is going to be like, as soon as TJ comes on, we'll ask him about his show. We'll ask him to promote things. And then, TJ, see you later.
He can come back before the Super Bowl. He's got time.
Hey, who knows, Marcus? Maybe if we had a platform where we could talk to guests and maybe do longer interviews and have that somewhere where, you know, it wouldn't take up so much bandwidth, but the audience that really wanted to hear TJ for, say, like 20 minutes, they could find that type of content.
You know you've already ruined the surprise, right?
I'm just putting hypotheticals out there, Marcus.
But you've already announced what we're doing.
I did. anybody that heard the show with John Pollock this past.
Oh, Sunday. I mean on this show too today.
Oh, I did?
Yeah, you totally missed it in. Yeah.
Oh well, it probably was when we were talking about Shad Khan, because you got me thinking about money with Shad and Tony. We're in the stages of launching a Patreon, but yeah, we know it's what do they call it, Marcus? We're in beta right now. We're not ready to bring it out to the people yet.
You're not in alpha? I don't know, but yeah, we're in beta.
we're not in alpha entertainment yet.
Or an omega.
Maybe that's what happened. Kenny Omega will sign with Alpha Entertainment. Play quarterback for the Los Angeles Desperados.
Yeah.
All right, TJ, he's up here dropping these cryptic clues. So let's bring TJ McAloon in.
All right.
Let's see. TJ McAloon. Maybe if I go back to my call or our call. So what are your thoughts, Marcus, real quick while I'm here patching TJ in terms of college football playoffs? Are you cool with four teams, or would you like to see the field expanded in following seasons?
I would like to see six teams and give your top two a bye.
Give them a bye.
Yeah, and that would allow your Power Five teams to get in, and then you have that one sort of wild card spot. So, you know, it's a UCF or maybe a school, another SEC stool that might have got snubbed at Georgia. So, or it could just be simple as the top six teams in the final playoff rankings. I mean, that's where the spotlight is on those six teams, and then you give your top two seeds a bye. So it makes it tough for, that's where the regular season matters. I mean, you need to win to have a higher seeding. So
I like that. I like that. I'm still partial to eight, but I could be persuaded to go with your six. Even, you know, maybe six is the stepping stone to get to eight. Like maybe we do six for two or three seasons,
mm-hmm.
and then we ultimately get to eight.
Yeah, I can't see them jumping from four to eight anytime soon. I think there has to be a middle step there.
That's not a bad idea, Marcus. It's not a bad idea. So yeah, anything to increase the chances of the people's champions, the UCF Golden Knights, getting into the dance, Marcus. That's what I'm here for.
Poor Golden Knights.
Yeah, man, that LSU game was something else.
I mean, they had a chance to tie it in theory. I mean,
yeah.
They had the ball down eight with time running out and then threw an interception, but LSU fans are beating their chests a little too hard about beating a UCF team that did not have their starting quarterback. So
yeah, I didn't get it, Marcus. Like, why were LSU fans and SEC fans so angry at UCF?
You know what happened last year?
Oh, with the national championship?
Well, no, losing to Auburn. I mean,
yeah.
UCF beat Auburn, and
yep.
I think they sort of sent a message to the SEC.
To me, they were the people's national champions.
They were. And what they did this year, losing their coach, I think was equally as impressive. And you figure if Mackenzie Milton doesn't get hurt, I think they have a fair shot at beating LSU.
Yeah. Especially with the one kid from LSU throwing punches.
Yeah.
Like, LSU was like mad for no reason. Like, it'd be one thing if UCF. It'd be one thing if UCF were out here talking about people's parents and stuff like that. I'm trying to set up TJ McAloon for the easy segue, but he's not picking up his phone right now.
TJ's about to get canceled, man.
Yeah, the only reason I really want to talk to TJ tonight is so I can play about the Dan Le Batard white guy's theme when he comes on. And really, I could play that with or without TJ.
You could.
I could play that with or without TJ McAloon, but I do believe TJ McAloon might be in the building.
TJ, are you there?
I might be wrong. Uh-oh.
All right, well.
I'll give him one more chance, and then we'll have to call it a show. And you know what? Maybe we will have to have that big interview with TJ available somewhere else. TJ going once? TJ going twice? I don't think we're talking to TJ this week, Marcus Van Burn. Wow.
NetSuite show, TJ McAloon, maybe.
Who's that? Is that your boy Jimmy Kimmel where the joke's always, my apologies to Matt Damon?
Oh, yes.
Ran out of time.
Yeah.
TJ will be our Matt Damon, which I'm sure the comparison makes him happy.
Yes.
TJ will be our Matt Damon, cause he is not picking up. And again, you know, no shade on TJ. Like, he's a busy man. He's got
a wife.
He's
got two kids. Two kids.
Yeah, two kids.
A wrestling promotion. He's hockey.
Yeah, he's got, I'll actually give TJ a plug. If you're in the Atlanta area for Super Bowl week, TJ, and Inspire Pro Wrestling are putting on a show the Saturday before the Super Bowl, like the night before the Super Bowl, TJ McAloon is holding a show. TJ is telling me he's on Skype right now. This is going to be funny. We should just bring him on to hang up on him.
Yeah.
That's so wrong. But it's so right. That's how we do in 2019. See, TJ McAloon. I bet if this were, Conrad Thompson, he would have been picked up the phone.
Oh yeah,
with big money, Conrad. TJ McAloon, are you there?
Well, hold on. Can you hear me?
Whoa!
Wow!
Is it
very loud? Wow! Look at you, sir.
Look at me. What do you mean? Look at me? What?
Hold on. Young. Wait a minute. We got. We must follow procedures. Somebody play TJ's theme music.
White guys,
that one is hot fire.
There it goes. TJ, Marcus and I were just saying, because we've got some good news and some bad news. The good news, TJ, is we want you to come and talk about your big show, Super Bowl week. We want to talk about the connection you have to All Elite Wrestling. The bad news, TJ, is this is a short show this week because we spent 3 hours with our best of show last week. So we're running low on bandwidth, brother. So
okay.
Now you got to get all your spots in, TJ. We ran long on the last.
Make it like a cruiserweight match from 1996, and I got 4 minutes.
Get all your spots in, Hoopin' too.
Which is Frank's. I thought you guys wanted me to come on and talk about what Trump just did on TV. I thought that's why you had me on.
Oh, I did not watch that.
I spent the last half hour in my 15-month-old room trying to get him to go down and then just monkeying around announcing Glacier on Twitter.
Yeah, you buried the lead, TJ. I was gonna build it up so you could hype up your big announcement.
No, well, it's already out there. Everything's already nothing is sacred anymore in today's world. Nothing. I spent the last 6 hours, or I spent about 6 hours with MJ on Sunday, and he said nothing of the ilk of appearing in Orlando today. So nothing is sacred.
All right, so TJ, Trump aside, I also Marcus, he didn't think we caught that, but TJ is putting his young impressionable children to bed with the lullaby of Donald Trump in the background. We see you, TJ. Mm-hmm.
Yes, we talk about boats and meet the press and all those fun things after sipping chai tea lattes.
He does live in Texas, so, I mean, you know, it makes sense.
TJ, I have been promoting your appearance for a while now because you actually do have something cool to let the people know about that's going down Super Bowl weekend. So, TJ, I'm going to let you hit all your high spots. Let the people know what you and Inspire Pro Wrestling have planned for
the Super Bowl. Here's the thing. So, Inspire Pro Wrestling, yes, is my company out of Austin, Texas, that I partner with Justin Bissonette and Max Meehan. We do everything under the sun. We just had a great show this past Sunday that was highlighted by ACH and Ricky Starks. Ricky is probably the best Texas talent going right now on the independent scene. So if you aren't aware of Ricky Starks, please go back, watch all of our stuff on our YouTube channel at Inspire Pro, or go check out Dojo Pro, the one season they did on Amazon Prime, where he is the only person outside of Aaron Solo to not be pinned on that series. So Ricky Starks is the next big independent wrestler that isn't signed by anybody. At least during this recording, he's not signed by anybody. Lord knows that can change in a minute by someone popping up somewhere. But no, he just had a match with ACH on Sunday, and Nick Gage just wrestled MJF last Sunday as well. So we had two amazing, amazing main events this past week. But coming up February 1st, January 31st, two shows, Atlanta, Georgia. For the first time ever, wrestling will be a part of Super Bowl weekend. It's never been done before. And this will be the first ever time that we'll be doing something, and the first ever time that Ken Shamrock will be involved in an event here in the States since 2009. And also the return of the Yeti, Glacier will be on the show, MJF, Scorpio Sky, Frankie Kazarian, Christopher Daniels, Pentagon Jr., Ray Phoenix.
Wow, what'd you choose? Yeah.
Tom Lawler, Simon Grimm, Ethan Page, Joey Ryan, I'm bearing, spoiling an announcement too. Joey Janela will be a part of the show too.
Ooh.
And I'll be four. Thunder Rosa, Delilah Doom, Eli Everfly, A.R. Fox, Priscilla Kelly, Darby Allin.
The Priscilla Kelly?
The Priscilla
Kelly. Oh, boy. I'm not going to go there. No.
Yeah, right. Well,
hey, respect the art, Marcus Vandenberg.
That's very true.
I respect the art.
Oh, and Matt Cross will be on both nights as well. So it's... And plus, you get the talents I cannot wait to work with, like Casanova Valentin, who is the king of the bar fight. I mean, the stuff he's done on YouTube is just, it's amazing, the stuff that he gets away with bloodying people and bringing out just death upon people. And also Effie. Effie will be a part of both nights as well.
Very cool. Very cool. A lot of big-time names, a lot of up-and-comers, a lot of folks from yesteryear. You know, we talk about people like Shamrock and Glacier, who I had the privilege to talk to a few years ago. He's a very down to earth dude.
And the Yeti. Don't forget about the Yeti.
The Yeti.
The Yeti.
But yeah, this seems like a very cool event. It's a wonder that, again, like you said, TJ, more companies haven't looked at the synergy, because I think if you did like a Venn diagram of wrestling fans and NFL fans, you probably got a lot of crossover.
That's what I'm banging on. And you know, the whole background of why these shows came about is one of our color commentators at Inspire Pro, Stu Myrick, he works with ESPN Austin, 104.9 The Horn, and he goes to Radio Row every single year for the last – or he's at Radio Row for the last 6 years. And every year, there's never a wrestling show. Wasn't one in Dallas. There wasn't one in Houston. Wasn't one in Santa Clara when it was up at the 49ers place. God, I'm trying to think where else were there. New York, when they had it in the Super Bowl for New York, New Jersey. As last year, I was texting him at about 10 o'clock at night, and I said, have you gone to any wrestling shows because it's in Minneapolis? Yes, there's nothing going on here. I'm like, what are you talking about? It's Minnesota. It's Minneapolis. It's, you know, the former home of, my brain's fried from this entire day. So
the Hennings and
the AWA.
AWA, yeah.
And what just Wrestle First or First Wrestling just did this past week, where they drew 1,100 people at their event. And I asked him, I'm like, what are you talking about? There's no wrestling going on. And he said, we've offered, you know, having Ring of Honor, I think Cody was a champion. Or no, I think it was Jay Lethal was a champion, who's their current champion now. They give Radio Row access, and they, you know, Corey and company turned them down. And then the closest thing that's ever been a wrestling event near the Super Bowl site was WWE had a house show in San Jose during the Santa Clara Super Bowl. So that's like 50 miles away from San Francisco. So that's like the closest it's ever come to. So my thought is, why go with 6,000 other companies doing WrestleMania weekend when you can be the only company and go test some new waters? And if it works, then you're a pioneer. If it doesn't work, well, at least someone put forth the effort and booked two shows during that weekend to see whether this is going to fly or not.
That's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. Like, you know, we take a lot of shots at TJ Marcus, many of them rightfully earned.
Of course.
But I actually think this is a pretty cool idea, and I hope it goes well.
That makes two of us, especially my bottom line. Also, it's going well too.
I don't want TJ to have to go back to stripping. No, nobody needs to see that.
God, no. Not at this age of 36 and two kids and cul-de-sac life.
Magic Mike just trying to get back in the game.
No, it's like...
I was hot back in 05, baby.
I won't be at Super Bowl, but I have a coworker that will be in a town, and she's a wrestling fan, so I sent along your links, TJ.
Yeah, please.
Just in case she has time to go.
Once I come by, you can find all of her information through the McAloon production, Twitter feed, and like I said, with Inspire Pro, this brings it all back to the original question. This all spawned off on a side project. It's, as Jeff Cobb said, it's like ginger spice going off from the Spice Girls on your ginger spice. I said, that sounds about right, Jeff Cobb. I'll take that, I guess. I was like, more so Joe Perry splitting off from Aerosmith, but if you want to compare me to Ginger Spice.
I mean, Ginger had that one hot single, then we never heard from her again until the reunion, but at least she had that one hot single.
And that's all I'm shooting for the wrestling show during the Super Bowl. Give me this one hot single. So yeah, it's my own production company that we're doing this this idea, and who knows what else big dumb ideas we'll do in, you know, later on in the summertime.
Sounds good. So that is TJ McAloon. I think what we'll do, TJ, is, you know, because Marcus and I were announcing that we are launching a Patreon.
There we go.
And so I think what we'll do, TJ, we'll talk to you after the big event, after the Super Bowl. And, you know, yes, we can actually sit down and have a longer conversation with you. And we'll make that a Patreon exclusive for the people out there.
I like it, because there's a lot of just bad, especially just all the stuff that happened today. And also I have a good PCO story about how he was originally booked to face Mil Mortis as my main event of one of the 2-1 come hella high water event, and all that unfolded from there and how that all completely just blew up my face, and how I originally had an original venue that I signed paperwork over for and was about ready to put deposits down, and they completely just punted on the whole entire idea. Mm. And also dealing with Shamrock, which has been a lot of fun as well.
I like it. So yes, that's a little bit of a tease. So everybody, where can the people go to find out more information about these shows, TJ?
So Eventbrite is where both shows are on sale currently right now. You can find tickets for either the 2-1 show, come hella high water, with being headlined by, well, I'll spoil the headline right now of what the main event is. It's going to involve Ken Shamrock, his first return to wrestling ring since 2009 in the States, Tom Lawler, Filthy Tom Lawler, Simon Grimm, Eddie Kingston, and one of my favorite tag teams going right now, the besties in the world, Davey Vega and Matt Fitchett. They're going to be involved in the main event. I think y'all can put two and two together what's going to happen in that one. Mm. 131, the ultimate bar brawl. No rules, no ring. It's going to be...
Kayfabe, bro. Kayfabe, come on.
That's why do you think Grimm and Lawler aren't wrestling as a tag team? That's another whole Patreon story right there about how MLW has been the giant thorn on my side this entire plan, this whole entire thing.
Ooh, interesting.
Oh, I got some hit him up for MLW.
We got beef that's coming up on his Patreon. We got some hot tea, if you will, from TJ.
That's all I can say about what's dealing with all them. But anyway, and if you can just sense the frustration and tiredness of my voice from that whole point right there. But, no, so 131, the ultimate bar brawl. First time ever we're doing things that just, they sound great, and we're going to pull them off. I don't know how, but it's just going to happen between the main event of Tom Lawler, Ken Shamrock, two worlds that are just, they're going to beat the living hell out of each other, and I don't know if I'm going to be able to have a show on 2-1 after the things they do to each other on 131. plus, we have the tag team event going on of Doomfly, Eli Everfly, and Delilah Doom, their fiancé and fiancée. I guess that's how you say that for them. They're engaged to be married. That's what I want to say. Taking on the actual married couple, Priscilla Kelly and Darby Allin, or Darby Allin. I don't know how you say his last name. It's the first time ever a tag team match at the no-ring show. Plus, you have the four-way elimination match of Effie, Matt Cross, Ethan Page, and the originator of the no-ring bar match, Casanova Valentin. Plus, you have the women's match, a first-time ever women's match, Penelope Ford against the one, the only ODB, One Dirty Bitch.
ODB!
What's he been up to?
I cannot... You cannot have a bar show without ODB being
that
involved.
That makes sense.
That is true. Just,
it'd be sacrilege.
She loves beer and barbecue sauce. That's a thing.
And that's another thing for Patreon. Me talking with ODB about bringing her trailer down from Minnesota down to Atlanta to sell barbecue as well.
She sells barbecue? Wait, I didn't know about this.
Yeah, she's got her own barbecue sauce business now.
Yeah. That's a shoot.
Yeah, so wow. Yo, this Patreon with TJ finna be hot. We might have to up the price on that, Marcus.
Wow.
I mean, had to put that on the exclusive tier.
Plus, I'll shorten the story here about how I got this club that's legit a half a mile from the Mercedes-Benz Stadium in Atlanta. Basically, they said we can't fit a ring in, but we'll still give you the club from 8 p.m. to 3 a.m. the Thursday before the Super Bowl. And I was like, I'd be dumb to turn this down. So I have a club in downtown Atlanta, the white kid from the suburbs who lives in a cul-de-sac with a little balding top of my head and drives.
What are you trying to say about Atlanta, huh? What are you trying to say?
I'm just saying.
I was going to say it, Marcus. Like, first day of Black History Month, one of the blackest cities in the Union. Like, what is TJ walking into?
Technically, I get it the last day of January, so I just escaped.
He just missed the blackness.
I did.
I mean, your show is going past midnight, right? You're going to bleed into the first day of February now.
Also true. That's a good point. Yep, I do.
So you should at midnight. You should pause the show and play some Outkast in honor of the first moments of Black History Month.
Technically, the show does go from 10 a.m. or 10 p.m. to midnight. So at midnight, when it does hit, ooh, and the show should go off the air, then yes, the club said, "What do you want to do after the show?" And I was like, "You can just play your own DJs. I really don't care.
I'm just worried about the wrestling."
Who knows? Maybe 2 Chainz will show up.
We got 2 Chainz, and I was trying to think of something fun, something witty for TJ, but we'll save that for the Patreon as well.
Yeah, right. No, it's just, I don't know, between your listeners and yourself need to look up Casanova Valentin and Barb Rawls. He was telling me this past weekend about how he took a spot and his head just cracked open and he bled all over the place. I was like, oh, God, please don't do that at my show. He's like, I'm good at death matches. I'm like, just don't do that, man. I don't want to clean that up. Plus, we will be at the open bar from 8 to 9 p.m. Before the show starts. Plus, also,
to live dangerously, TJ, with your
and on top of all that, we have Frankie Kazarian's metal band, Gutter Candy, playing from 8:30 to 10 p.m. before the show.
Oh, wow.
I'm trying to figure out what else I could do. I talked to Brian Pillman Jr., who also will be on the 2-1 show, about getting a DDP yoga session early in the morning on Friday. He's like, I don't think he wants to do that. I'm like, all right, whatever. And we'll be on Radio Row too on Thursday and Friday.
Okay, good job, TJ. That's using your business mind, TJ. Take advantage of all your avenues out there.
Ah, there's a lot going on. You could say I'm really going triple or nothing on this show.
So I was gonna say you're all in, TJ. So bringing it all the way back. Who knows? Maybe Trevor Lawrence will show up, and that'll tie it into the national championship game.
That's another thing. Sorry, you're thinking of football players. I got a good story with George Kittle and his agent about him wanting money. And I was like, I'm not paying George Kittle money to come to my show.
Even though he'll be in town probably. That's weird.
Yeah.
Pentagon Jr. and Ray, and George does his Sierra Meadow taunt every time he scores a touchdown. So I reached out to his agent and said, George should come by.
Hey, man, Marcus, this Royal Rant has been pretty fun, but like I'm just waiting. Like the people once we get back with TJ after he does his show Super Bowl week, this sit down with TJ is going to be fascinating.
Yes,
all these behind the scenes stories. So you got that to look forward to, folks. TJ, if people want to find you on these Twitter streets, where can they find you at?
The company's page is Kloon Production. Kloon, Kloon Production.
We'll say Kloon, not Kloon. Correct.
Yeah.
That's your other page. That's your personal page.
Yeah, the personal page, the burner account is at TJ McAloon. That's the burner one where I yell at people, like Katie, if they say something mean about my show. Like someone, I love wrestling fans, but sometimes, man, they come to me and they say like, oh, I bet Ken Shamrock's going to throw this fight. And I'm like, it's a wrestling match, you dummies.
I've always said, Marcus, TJ is like he's like a likable Will Kane. That's what TJ is.
Except I don't have my Steelers in here to go throw it at everybody's faces, which, Marcus, go Rams. I would appreciate a Rams Super Bowl. And all SCU Super Bowl will be fun for Frankie and Chris and Scorpio being there. In fact, the shows are very heavy LA-based with Joey Ryan, Pentagon, Ray, SCU, Doomfly, and also Chris Wolf coming from LA as well at the time. So I would love a Rams-Chargers Super Bowl, but I'm really pulling for the Eagles because give me those Philadelphia fans in town for wrestling and just get the game.
That's a fair point.
And to buy a bunch of alcohol as well for my bar show.
Yeah, that'll be crazy.
You have a good core of Atlanta wrestling fans. They show up. They'll show up.
Yeah, but not pre-sale show up. Like if Philly makes the Super Bowl, they will pre-sale show up. So, daddy needs his money.
Yeah, that'll be crazy. Brother Marcus. Where can people find you on these social media streets if they want to talk to you about what's going on, maybe some certain named or unnamed current or former USC coaches? Where can they find you on these streets to holler at you?
Find me at Marco Will, MarcoWill.
Do you have any burner accounts we should know about?
I have no burner accounts, Nate.
Okay.
Except for the ones who'll be tweeting from the Coliseum this Saturday, whenever Jerry World invades town.
Oh boy, that's gonna be interesting.
And you can find me on Twitter at @NateMosaik at Nate Mosaic. You can check out the show, CosPod, KOS_POD. Follow us on Facebook, facebook.com/KingsOfSport. Go to iTunes, Stitcher, Podcast Addict, Google Podcast, Spotify, iHeartRadio Podcast, wherever you're getting your podcast from, we are there. Subscribe to the show, like, rate, review, and most importantly, if you dig what we're doing, share the show with your friends. A little bit of a heads up, this coming Friday, not the Friday this week, but Friday the next, Friday the 18th, I believe Marcus and I are making a pimp decision. Not only is that going to be the day that my new show with Post Wrestling, the Rocky Maivia Picture Show, that's not only the day that launches, but I think, Marcus, that's going to be the day when we launch our Patreon.
All right.
Get ready. So, yes, get ready for that. We've already got a couple shows we've been working on that may or may not be finished and may or may not be in the can. But we're working on that for you. And next month, we're going to have that exclusive, like the Barbara Walters interview with TJ McAloon.
It's going to be the one where I just sigh for about an hour and a half and go, God damn it, let me tell you about this story.
When TJ just sympathizes with everything Vince McMahon's had to go through the last 50 years.
So much easier to do a small indie show here in Austin rather than a big dumb show right in the middle of the Super Bowl.
So yeah, you got that to look forward to, man. And women. I don't know why I just made this a gender thing.
On equal pay scale.
There you go.
Equal pay scale, health benefits. There's a lot of things, interesting things going on in the wrestling business right now. And in the world. So I'm gonna let TJ get back to, rocking his kids to sleep with Donald Trump playing as a lullaby in the background.
Try hiding in my media room while SmackDown Live finishes and I book 16 more flights for this upcoming dumb show.
Oh man.
Have fun with that. I know so many wrestlers' birthdays, real names, and all that fun stuff. It's just dumb information.
Hey,
I don't
babe, don't tell me. Keep it
I will not spoil Jeff Cobb's real name.
Oh, thank you. Oh, damn, Carmella, why did you just land on your face?
Sorry.
I just watched the SmackDown here in the background. Yeah, we're going to let TJ get back to business because TJ has got a big show coming up, as he just said. We're going to let Marcus get back to being petty. Cause it is the new year and, you know, pettiness never sleeps. And I am going to get back to, editing that Rocky Maivia Picture Show episode where Brian Mann and I talk about the Scorpion King longer than any rational human being should talk about the Scorpion King. So we're all busy. but thank you for listening to this week's edition of the show. We're trying to keep it short to save bandwidth and, we'll be back next week with an all new edition of the world's most dangerous sports show, the Kings of Sport podcast. So, for TJ McAloon, for Marcus Vandenberg, I am the Godfather Nate Milton. Happy New Year and good night, Kelly Bryant, wherever you are, because you've been down with the Kings.
What in the wide, wide world of sports is going on here?
Well, that's it for this edition of the Royal Rant. Agree with our take? Think we're off base? Or maybe you've got something completely different that you need to vent about? Well, tell us why you're mad on Facebook, facebook.com/thekingsofsport, or on Twitter, CosPod on Twitter. That's KOS_POD, CosPod on Twitter.
Time is really wasted. I try to play my music.
Let me tell you something, Mean Gene. I'm gonna go out there and I'm gonna leave it all on the mat, because that's what I do when I get it done so I can do it. Yeah!